Hi, and welcome back to another installment of Straight Talk with Egypt McKee. I got to tell you, something reflects on me right now, and that's third time, it's a charm. Means a whole lot to me right about now. Welcome to the show. I tell you, this is a part B, part two, extension of the topic on fear. You know, we began last week and last episode really discussing with some special guests about the aspects of fear in the areas of physical, verbal, and social, i.e. relationship type fear. And every single person on the planet deals with fear in a multiple range and assortment of flavors. Here's the problem. It's not so much what happens to you when fear approaches you, it's how you respond to it. And it's not just an answering and responding with the right question, and that's how you should actually respond in that moment. But the path of least resistance isn't always the thing that brings us to a place of peace. For example, you know, I've spent a good part of my life, certainly over the last 15 to 18 years as a professional skydiver. Yes, I do jump out of perfectly good airplanes from about 2.5 miles up. And I'll tell you, something was learned through that process is not just overcoming fear, but being able to manage my fear and actually put it into a healthy place. Now, I won't lie to you. Every time I actually go up in altitude and I'm sitting on an airplane and I look out that door and people are the sizes of green beans, I will tell you I have a healthy respect and a healthy fear for gravity. You know, when I climb out of that plane and I'm actually in free fall, screaming into the earth at about 150 to 225 miles per hour, as much as that's fun to me, some of you might be thinking, you so crazy. Well, I do that to actually relax because that's just how I roll. And maybe you'll join me sometime, you know what I'm talking about. But the truth of the matter is that fear for me is not that I'm operating out of fear, otherwise I'd certainly be dead to this point. But I actually have learned how to manage my fear and put it in its proper place so that I actually maintain a healthy respect for the reality in front of me, but I also am able to overcome the obstacle in front of me. And this is one of those cool things that we just get to do around the show. I've always said from the first day that I can remember a long time ago, and that is this: I'm willing to connect with anyone willing to connect. You know, I don't care if you're a so-called A-list celebrity in Hollywood, or you're a fireman, or you're a missionary on the fields and serving the impoverished and the poor and the needy out in some distant land. It really doesn't matter who you are. I'm willing to connect with you if you're willing to connect with me. One of the greatest joys I get to have is to build relationships with people who actually matter most, and that's those who actually have a heart and a joy for other people. And I want to begin with my first guest. You saw him last episode. Well, he's back. Yes, it's Steve Cornett. Very dear friend of mine who actually has a testimony and a story that is transforming lives everywhere, starting with mine and certainly his own life. So as he journeys through, he's going to share with you a spoken word poem that he has written specifically for you today. Sit back and enjoy. Welcome, Steve Cornett.
Thanks for having me back, Egypt.
I just wanted to encourage some of you who are going through fear right now that when you overcome your fear, you'll be able to show someone else how to overcome their fear, and you just pay it forward. So don't give up hope, and know that your breakthrough is right around the corner. So I got another poem for you. I hope you enjoy it. You've given me a heart that beats for you, lungs that breathe for you, and a voice that sings to you. May my acts personify the personal love that you have bestowed upon my soul. From wretchedness through grace, you've made me whole, complete, restored me to my Creator, God Almighty, my Abba, my Father. See, there's no turning back from you, because you held nothing back from me. Crucified your only Son so I could freely be one with you. Yes, I was chosen by you, which means I matter to you. No matter the ladder I chose to climb, you were with me rung for rung, hoping that I'd find you. You kept me safe in my life of darkness. God, I can't thank you enough, so dig this. I give you my life as a canvas to paint whatever portrait you do wish. I'm yours. Fallen madly in love with this process of being molded into your image. Making me a frontline warrior, I'm seeing Jesus in visions. Calling me to a battlefield no human eyes can see. Opening up my true eyes towards a spirituality. Yes, through my solidarity, you solidified your spirit as a passion running its course through my veins, internally changing me, my heart, my soul, and my brain. Because of your great love, God, I'll never be the same. So use this life that you've given me to bring others to your name. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Steve. I tell you what, again, man, you're knocking it out of the park. I love the fact that you think through what you're saying and you convert that into a message that can be easily understood, easily received, but more importantly, easily practiced in life. Thank you for encouraging our souls today. Hope you were lifted up by that. And I gotta tell you, if you sit back long enough and really listen through life, there's a few things that you're gonna catch that are gonna be consistent on this show. One, you matter, because you really do. Number two, I believe in you. I really, really do. And number three, yeah, there's a hope for you that goes far beyond my mind and my imagination, and that's the mind of your Creator. He loves you. I believe He has a name. I specifically call Him the Christ, the Son of God. So that's my message for you today. Stay encouraged and stick with us. But before we do so, I'm going to go back to our former guest for the first installment of this Part A series on fear. And before I do and introduce her, I want to talk about our theme today, because this is the place where it all starts happening. You know, where the junk in life, all the cat fights and all of the, you know, he said, she said, and all the posts get taking place in life. Usually on the internet, we call that cyberbullying, cyber fear, all of the mess that comes out of that. But then there's this big dynamic of sex as well. And sex is such a destructive tool. Why? Because we have relationships where we actually think that we can buy and sell, almost like a commodities market, like a stockbroker, but a sex broker. You know, we get to the point where we think that our identity is our sexuality. Some of you have been living an entire life where you actually think you are identified by your sex. How pathetic. Yeah, I actually said the word pathetic. Now, in a way, you think, oh my gosh, did he just say that to me? He's intolerant. Well, I want you to repeat what you just said and then really look at yourself in the mirror and then say it again so that you can see how foolish that sounds. I'm not cutting you up or cutting you down, but I'm just actually helping you unzip the reality of the stupidity that we've actually put on ourselves, because we have a bunch of people who are not only, you know, this idea of intolerance, we have this unhealthy fetish for getting to a place in life where we only feel like the fear that we can condone is the fear that we thrust on other people, and whatever their vision or understanding of it is somehow how we navigate and bump up against that in life, and that's where we find our identity. Your sexuality is not your identity. I want to be very, very clear about that. Your identity is so much something deeper, someone more purposeful, something that actually stands the test and trials of all the ridiculousness that we've seen floating around in the world today. So, I want to talk to you about my special guest. I'm honored to have her back. She is Brittany Salisbury, the founder of Fearless Daughters. And I tell you what, I love her heart. Love everything about her. She's got a message that I think is going to change and shape you for the rest of this show, and certainly for a lifetime. Welcome back, Brittany.
I'm back. And I am so ready to tackle this topic with you, Egypt.
You know what, Brittany, I tell you what, I love this. I wish we could just do this, no commercials, and you know, we would just roll it how we roll it. So let's start from the top here, because today we're shifting gears just a little bit. We're still on this theme of fear, but you know, now we're looking at a couple different aspects of fear, because you know, there's a whole issue of cyberbullying and cyber fear. And what he said, she said, or somebody said about somebody else, or somebody hashtagged about somebody. All right, so there's that whole aspect. And then there's a much bigger piece. And this is a scary piece, because that's that sexual fear. It's that intimidation. And, you know, so many sub-bullets can come down underneath that. And what my concern is that we have a lot of people watching today, right now, and they're clued in on this sexual piece, because you know, it's like, well, what are you talking about in sexual? Is that date rape? Is that molestation? Is that sex trafficking? Is that some sort of sexual intimidation or bartering? Yeah, it's all of that.
Yeah.
And that's a scary thing. So let me open up with this scenario. This is not here in America, but this is what happened. And some of my guests, such as Steve Cornett, are spoken word poet who really did a fabulous job earlier in the show.
Yeah.
He actually joined me two summers ago and both Kenya and Uganda, and we saw this lived out live. Hmm. We visited a school, and the school was made up of 150 students, so 75 girls and 75 boys, at a private school. But I'm going to tell you what was happening in this school. These are all high school age, teenage, young people. And because of the culture there, young girls, when they have their monthly cycle, they are not able to really come to school because as a part of their culture, they can't afford pads.
Wow.
So we saw a need, and what did we do? We swooped in and we bought cases of pads. But what was sad about that is we heard some testimonies. Several of the girls actually sat down with several of my female team leaders and confessed to them this bartering that had been going on. A lot of the boys figured this out, and what they would do is they would say, listen, I will buy you pads if you have sex with me.
Wow.
And a lot of these girls are losing their virginity because obviously education is king, and you don't want to be out of school. You certainly don't want to miss school. So these girls are missing anywhere from a week to 10 days to 2 weeks, depending upon their flow, be it heavy or light. Now listen, as a dad and as a husband, as a man, as a realist, I can talk like that. It's not my life, but I can tell you this. I have enough girls in my house to know what that looks like every single month. And this is a devastating form of sexual intimidation and manipulation, which I thought was sickening. I could have tackled every single one of them boys and beat the snot out of them and put some truth in them. But see, you can't beat up every situation, and like, I think I might want to tackle some problems. But that's kind of where I want to kick this thing off a little bit. I know you've got some things that are near and dear to your heart, not so much in a sense of passion, like you enjoy talking about it, but you've had some experiences in life which were traumatic, were personal. So let's kind of open up that can right there and begin that discussion.
Well, first, I mean, I guess just hearing that story with the women, I know that sexual assault, sexual harassment is really prevalent over there in third world countries. So it's always so hard to hear. And why it's so hard to hear, I think, for women like me is I experienced something similar. I was sexually assaulted probably about my first year in college, though. So I went to community college and I went and got my degree at a four-year university. So it was my third year into college, and it was at a school here in LA. And you know, it was that classic, you know, date rape, drugged, and also he was the person who did it was held for kidnapping. So there was kidnapping involved, and it was just a very intense, you know, situation. I felt, you know, I'm a believer. I felt like God had protected me in that situation because majority of the night that I was being held, and the experiences, I blacked out. And so I really was thankful that I didn't remember all the traumatic experiences that happened throughout the night. But I have little glimpses here and there, or I had memories here and there of the incident, and it was enough to get him arrested. The day that I reported him, and I remember the fear of just like, what is this man gonna do to me? Because he was a very dark man. He was involved in a lot of demonic, satanic things, into porn, just very lost, and so knew a lot of, you know, corrupt people, gangbangers, and so I figured, you know, maybe my life would be over because I'm reporting him. And thankfully, I was protected. The detectives, the cops were really good with me. They stayed with me.
Good.
And it was just like a really long process, you know, a year-long court craziness. He sent people to my school to intimidate me. I had two private investigators follow me for a year because that's just a process in a sexual assault court case is they want to follow you and get as much crap on you as possible so that they can use it against you and say that you wanted it.
Right.
You know, and so went through this whole thing and, you know, suffered a little bit of humiliation because I was now known as a rape girl on my campus. And so that was really hard. And so just so many different aspects, like I said. And then after a year, the case was dropped because there wasn't enough evidence. And I remember going through just a lot of anger and just being like, you know, I went through so much and where's the justice? But, you know, all the detectives and the cops, they told me that we believe you. We know that what you're saying is true. It's just that there's not enough evidence, and you're not the first person he did this to, but you're the first person to report it. And so I always say, if you have dealt with any kind of sexual assault, you always report it. Who cares about the outcome? Because if you report it, then it also goes on their record and they'll think right. twice about hurting someone else. And so I do not regret going through all that pain, you know, with the court, because it is a lot. You know, you do go yeah. through a lot of, you know, stuff, you know, in the courtroom that it can get really ugly, but it's so worth it because you do have a voice, you know. A lot of times people want to take our voices away. And one thing I want to encourage women is just to use it, because it's something that no one can take away from you. Refuse to be silent. So that's a little bit about my story in that aspect. And so now I have such, you know, a heart and compassion for women who deal with that, because I know it's not easy and it happens all the time. It's happening, yeah. you know, at jobs, it's happening with teachers and students, you know, even with teenage boys and girls, it's happening with them. And it's just really unfortunate. It's just, it's everywhere, you know?
So, you know what? Oh. My heart is so heavy just listening to this, Brittany, because you're a real person. This experience is real. There's nothing about this that is trivial or simple. Mm. And let's just work ourselves from back to front for a second. First thing is, I love what you said about encouraging our viewers. And I want to be clear about something here, because there's an unspoken market, sadly, in this. It is predominantly women who are sexually assaulted.
Right.
I think the numbers overwhelmingly justify that. But I also want to say there is a large contingent of men who are also sexually assaulted. I know this yeah. seems bizarre. It seems like, well, believe me, trust me, the numbers substantially support that as well. But regardless of your assault, your experience, Brittany has made it clear, report that. Mm-hmm. You are going to live in a period of bondage for the remainder of your life and be crippled by not just the act, but it's the repeated regeneration and reintroduction of the act on a daily, maybe minute by minute basis that will and can consume you, can utterly destroy you. That in and of itself is a dangerous place to be. Now, going all the way back to the beginning, and we'll talk about this in just a moment when I come back with Brittany, that is this idea of boundaries, establishing healthy boundaries in your life. You know, Brittany pointed out some things I've got to tell you that are just mind-boggling to me, that this man had a very dark past, mm-hmm. pornography addiction, likely, you know, satanic and occult type, you know, affiliations. All of those things lead up to this act.
Yeah.
You see, I'm gonna ask you a really gross question right now. What is the upside of sexual fear? Meaning, what's the best that can come out of it? You know what the best that can come out of it is? Rape, molestation, violence, abuse of every kind. And you might say, well, what kind of a reward is that, or an upside is that? That's the point I'm trying to make. That is what happens when a person is invested in fear at that level. Hold on to that thought. I'm gonna come back to you, Brittany, in just a minute. We're gonna pick this up in just a second. But before we do so, I wanna have you take a look at a new clip out. This movie's already out, but it's one of my favorite because it really asks some very poignant questions, some basic questions that some of you as skeptics might well be asking. The movie trailer is God's Not Dead. Enjoy.
You prayed and believed your whole life, and here you are. Explain that to me.
What do you say to people that are offended by your show?
Because you pray to Jesus in every episode.
If we disown him, he'll disown us.
When a 12-year-old watches his mother dying of cancer, a God who would allow that is not worth believing in. Life is really a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury and signifying nothing.
Name? Wheaton. Josh Wheaton. Philosophy 150.
You might want to think about a different instructor.
Come on, man, it can't be that bad.
Think Roman Colosseum. People cheering for your death.
I'm Professor Radisson. This is Philosophy 150. I would like to bypass senseless debate altogether and jump to the conclusion, which every sophomore is already aware of: there is no God. All that I require from each of you is that you fill in the papers I've just given you with three little words: God is dead. Mr. Wheaton, is something wrong?
I can't do what you want. I'm a Christian.
If you cannot bring yourself to admit that God is dead, then you will need to defend the antithesis.
Think of Jesus as my friend.
You think Jesus is God?
I don't want to disappoint him. So your acceptance of this challenge may be the only meaningful exposure to God and Jesus they'll ever have.
See, to me, he's not dead. I don't want anyone to get talked out of believing in him just because his professor thinks they should.
Mr. Wheaton, are you ready?
We're going to put God on trial.
If you think you're smarter than me, Wheaton, do not try to humiliate me in front of my students. In that classroom, there is a God. I'm him.
This experiment is over. You get to decide who the most important person in your life is. Me, Professor Radisson.
But I have to do this thing. Like it's something that God wants me to do. I can't just turn away from it.
You just want to ensnare them in your primitive superstition.
What I want is for them to make their own choice. That's what God wants.
You have no idea how much I'm going to enjoy failing you.
Yeah, but who are you really looking to fail? Me or God?
God's not dead. He's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. God's not dead. He's surely alive.
Supports his existence. You know the truth. So why do you hate him? It's a very simple question. Why do you hate God?
God's not dead. He's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion.
And we're back. And I got to tell you, I'm back with my guest, Brittany Salisbury, founder of Fearless Daughters, doing an amazing work in helping to restore not only the respect and dignity, but the peace in young women everywhere. You need to listen to what she's got to say. Brittany, I want to pick up from our previous discussion before the movie trailer, and I want to paint for you a scenario, because there are lots of young women out there. And you know what? Let me just remove that kind of predecessor there. This idea of young women, there are a lot of women, period, mm-hmm. who are struggling with this right here, this component. And that is that, you know, I've been with my boyfriend, possibly my husband, and I've been sexually assaulted. I love him, but something's wrong here. And I've been blaming myself because somehow I felt like maybe I deserved it. So I just shut my mouth and, you know, I never really shared it with anybody. But I don't know what to do because I keep coming back to this place of restlessness. And deep inside of me, I've lost respect for him. I actually hate him. And I want to tell someone, but I'm afraid something's going to happen to me and I don't know what to do or what to say. What do you say to that kind of young or woman?
That's such a tough question. I feel like every situation is unique, especially if the assault just happened. And you definitely want to report it right away because the sooner the better as far as the evidence part goes. I know a lot of women love their boyfriend or love their husband and they don't want to see them face jail time. So yeah. I always say, you know, use discernment in that you can separate yourself from them. You can get, you know, proper boundaries. You can seek counseling and help for yourself. You know, that's one option. Obviously seek counseling and help in general, but if you do not want to go through the whole law, you know, and cops and all that stuff, you know, there's always just a way of just pulling back, separating yourself from him. I mean, even restraining orders are really helpful.
Yeah.
But yeah, for the woman who, you know, has to report them, I would say that you just have to do it because you will feel so ugly inside about, you know, what if I would have stood up for myself? You'll feel more encouraged and empowered that you actually did something for yourself. And just get people that you know and you love and that you trust to come around you, to walk alongside of you. There's so many resources, there's so many different nonprofits that offer help to this area. And so there is help out there. Know that you're not alone. I know that Fearless Daughters will be there. You can always contact us. I know Egypt has a wonderful just group of people, ministry that will also help. So there is hope for you. And yes, just don't be afraid.
And Brittany, isn't there always the argument as well that I think a lot of women struggle with this? If I do something, if I do report, then I'm going to be hurt. But if I don't do something, I'm going to remain hurt. So the balance of all of that is no matter what happens,
right,
I'm gonna be hurt.
Yeah, you're gonna be hurt regardless, so you might as well do something about it. Yeah, yeah, definitely. And that's why I always say definitely, definitely report it, because honestly, if you don't say anything, then it's just gonna continue. I know that one of the motivations for me is that I have such a heart for women. I was like, if I don't say anything, then this could possibly happen to another woman, and I would never want that to happen to another woman. So I know if I take a stand now, yeah, and do what I can and use my voice, it will limit him from abusing or hurting someone else.
Absolutely, so. Absolutely, couldn't agree more. Well, Brittany, we're unfortunately, you know what, there's never enough time, especially when I get to hang out with you. But let's do this. I want to give you the last word. Why don't you look into the camera and appeal to our audience? You know, again, we got a lot of 20-somethings and 30-somethings out there watching you right now. And I know you've got a word that is encouraging for them, but I want you to be able to share that. Go ahead.
Yeah, I just want to say honestly that I am sorry for any mistreatment or abuse that you have endured. Definitely you are not alone. You don't have to go through this life feeling helpless or weak or defeated, living full of fear. That's not how your life is meant to be lived out. You can live in abundance and full of peace and joy and happiness. And I know for me as a believer, we cling to Jesus, and we know that through him we can do all things, and that he brings so much restoration and peace and wholeness. And so whatever, wherever you're at right now, I just ask that you would take steps to get out of your comfort zone, to seek healing and seek restoration and to fight, because once you're out of this life, there is no more fighting. So fight now. You're worth it. You have so much value. You have so much worth. And just because you started off at a rough patch doesn't mean that you're gonna end that way. You can always choose and make better choices to end your circumstance in a better way.
And couldn't have been said better myself. Well, Brittany, thank you for being my special guest. You are always welcome back, and
I look forward
to having you back again in the future. Thanks, Brittany.
Thanks.
And that's all the time we have today. Again, I'm Egypt McKee, your host. Why don't you connect with us on Facebook at facebook.com/EgyptSpeaks. Same on Instagram, instagram.com/EgyptSpeaks, and also YouTube/EgyptSpeaks. And finally, out there on Twitter, why don't you follow us in #StraightTalkWithEgypt. Love to see you soon. I am the above average Egypt McKee, and I'm here because I believe in you. Come back, join us again for next time. We'll see you soon.